university and particularly our department have always been interested in this topic. So I thought it's very befitting that we collaborate with Calcutta Research Group on this topic, particularly because we started this discussion in this university about 10 years back on the Southern Silk Route. The volume is still, you know, it's under the supervision of Manohar and it's going to come out very soon. So we will have another occasion to discuss and mull over these issues with you. Before, you know, without wasting too much time, let us now go to the main part of the program. May I request C. Rajamohan to be here. And also, of course, Professor Hari Vasudevan. Mohan is currently the director of Carnegie India, but he is to us known as a professor in JNU, as well as he's currently also the foreign affairs columnist of Indian Express. We are all familiar with his writings. He is a visiting professor to the Singapore National University. Previously, he had also been a professor at the Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. We are also aware that he was part of the National Security Advisory Board, and all of us are very familiar with his new book as well, that is Modi's World, Expanding India's Sphere of Influence. One bit that surprised the resume is that master's degree, so that gives us an idea why he's so interested on what is considered as the hard issues of diplomacy. So I'm delighted to be able to present Dr. C. Rajamohan.
Thank you. I think the podium is high enough, so I thought we'll speak from here. So let me begin by thanking the Calcutta Research Group for inviting me here. Though I've heard of the group, I've not had a chance to visit you, so it's really particularly a privilege to be here with this group. I also wanted to thank Professor Banerjee for chairing this session and for introducing me. I also wanted to pleasure always to be with Professor Hari Vasudevan. We've been conspirators for quite some time, so such a delight to be with you on this panel. It's always a privilege to come to Calcutta because when I used to be associated with the ORF, I had a chance to come more often, but it's always had a special resonance for me. For those of us who are interested in modern India's geopolitics, there is no escaping Calcutta, because this is where much of the conception of modern India's territoriality, much of modern India's expansionary vision under the Raj were constructed. So it's a great privilege to be here to reflect, I think, on some of the issues of connectivity and geopolitics, though it's politically not correct that many of the things today when we talk about connectivity, about Silk Roads, a lot of it you could see under the British Raj itself, that the Raj was doing quite a bit of the so-called connectivity. Today when Xi Jinping runs a big campaign, of course it's a big global initiative. Everyone is interested in the OBOR, and if you're lazy, it just becomes BR, B and R, like black and white or whatever, B and R initiative, Belt and Road initiative. But if you summarize the great initiative, what you're really talking about is to create corridors of routes, of trading routes, or industrial corridors, and build some big port cities, which is exactly what the British Raj was doing here, that the cities like Calcutta, Madras, Bombay, Hong Kong, Singapore were all created as part of the expansionary European capitalism in which India became one of the principal bases. And the resources of India, I mean, the relationship might have been colonial, but it is also one of partnership in some sense. The British couldn't have done without the resources that India offered or the location that India had offered. So therefore, that this is not something new, this is something old, but I think what I see happening today in many ways is what India tried to do before, but a lot less successfully, and that today what China is doing is going to have a far more sweeping, comprehensive consequences for the whole region. So the idea is to talk about some of these issues under the general title, Reconnecting the Subcontinent, India and the New Silk Roads. For almost a decade, I think connectivity, those of you who are doing international relations or follow what the South Asian governments are up to, the focus has been so much on connectivity. If you just pick up any SAARC declaration of the last 10 years, you see a lot of focus on connectivity. You pick up the speeches of Manmohan Singh, now Modi, or before even Vajpayee. The reference to connectivity of reintegration of the subcontinent had become a strong theme. But more recently, of course, you had the American initiative on a New Silk Road, which Hillary Clinton talked about in 2011. Hasn't gone too far, we'll talk about it. Then you have the Chinese initiative, the OBOR I mentioned to you a little while ago, and the Japanese initiative too. I mean, the Japanese, there's little discussion of the Japanese initiative. They have an initiative called the Partnership for Quality Infrastructure, which is a fairly substantive, and I think the Japanese are putting in a lot of resources, and we're going to talk about some of that too. But I think the scale and the scope and the kind level of interest today in corridors and connectivity is unprecedented, and its consequences too are going to be extraordinary and will have great significance in the decades to come, and not just in terms of what happens to the power politics, but in terms of what it does to space, physical space, how we think of physical space around us is going to alter fundamentally if some of these initiatives begin to succeed in the coming years. India's own response has been ambivalent, to say the least. We don't say yes to the Chinese, we don't say no to the Chinese. The whole range of initiatives that the Chinese have proposed, India's had problems, and I think I'm going to discuss some of that in the discussion. We've also seen Prime Minister Narendra Modi trying to energize some of the initiatives that were actually taken by the previous government. But yet, there are going to be problems in its implementation, so that's going to be another theme today's talk. So what I thought I'll do in the next 40-45 minutes or so is to look at the history, the geography and the politics shaping the current Silk Road initiatives, examine India's current approach, look at how the present government might be developing a forward-looking strategy for this, and to conclude, a little bit of sense of what it might do to Calcutta as a great city in the coming decades. So that's the six-part story that I have to present before you. To start with history, I mean, I think the subcontinent, I mean, of course, a lot of people still quarrel about subcontinent, what is the exact term, South Asia, India, undivided India, whatever it is. But I prefer the word subcontinent. I think the subcontinent has had expansive connectivity in the past. I mean, I think it's not as if today we are trying to do connectivity to the region. Overland connectivity, maritime connectivity, over the millennia were fairly strong in the subcontinent. Across the Indian and the Pacific Oceans, monks and merchants always had moved along in different paths, taking ideas, taking spiritualism, taking goods. So you had an expansive interaction of coastal trade. Many of the historians have written about it. But much of that was really within, under forces of production, shall we say, to use an old term, an old-fashioned term, it was essentially of a low quality, that it was really agrarian peasant societies at best are trading with each other. But even within that framework, the power of connectivity, you could see in the form of Buddhism, how Buddhism traveled out of India, through the Himalayas, through the seas, to far corners of Asia. We also saw Islam actually, though it started in the Arabian Peninsula, in fact the subcontinent played a big role in transmitting it further to Southeast Asia, and the role of, for example, in Gujarat, the traders of Gujarat and the networks that the traders of Gujarat have had a significant role in spreading Islam through Southeast Asia. Then, of course, we have this colonial age, the Vasco da Gama age, if you prefer, the origin of modern capitalism, the maritime transformation, because in fact the maritime age is linked to the capitalist age, though how much we celebrate there was an Indian Ocean before the colonial era. It was largely a coastal one, a primitive trading networks, to one where when capitalism connects markets and production centers in different parts of the world, moving resources, goods, people, you're talking about the nature of that interaction and integration under capitalist expansion is huge, is dramatic, and I think that's what we saw happen since the beginning of the 16th and the 17th centuries. Of course, it reached a peak under the British Raj, which was where the British, having united this large mass of territory into a coherent political unit of a kind, which then begins to explore beyond the subcontinent, opening markets, whether it is for opium or whether it is for tea, whether it is for something else. The fact that the Raj could begin to open up, look beyond the Himalayas, look beyond the seas, to explore new areas around this. And it is also, as we've seen, that it was not merely economic. The Indian Army, for almost 200 years, was the principal security provider. Those of you who read Thomas Metcalfe's brilliant book, it's called Horizontal Connections, essentially positing that, look, India was not a post office for London, that India had agency under the Raj, and that Indian capital, Indian resources, Indian ideas were used in partnership with the British, who was the number one power at that point of time, and that the when we talked about the Indian Ocean as a British lake, it involved a partnership between India and Britain, Indian resources and Britain, in extending Indian law. For example, those of you who go to Singapore or Malaysia today, the Indian Criminal Code, is still used in the courts, because the British, having invented a legal system that combined some of the Western practices with those of the East, then it could slap it around in different parts of the world. If you look at architecture, I think whether you go to Kenya, whether you go to Malaysia, whether you go to the East, what is called the Indo-Saracen architecture, the British didn't have their own architecture. They integrated the Mughal style into the Greek style, and then you see that colonial buildings in Delhi, in Singapore, in KL, in various other places you see. So in a sense that there was this center, this large entity called the subcontinent in the center, actually helped create this larger networks of trade, of movement of capital, of movement of people, that the Indian labor, you saw expansionary movement of the Indian labor from Fiji to Jamaica, that Indian capital, I think today recent studies prove how much of the Indian capitalists had in the expansion of rice cultivation in Myanmar, or the rubber cultivation in Malaya, or settling of the islands of Kenya, that it was not just the British capital that was operating, that there was actually the Chettiar capital in the south, or the Parsi capital, or the whole range of groups in India which had contributed to the expansion of the networks in the Indian Ocean. So in a sense, historically, this was a massively connected region. And mind you, we're only talking about a minimal amount of globalization that the British did to the Indian society, that they were merely scratching the surfaces of this vast subcontinent, created a few urban spaces, connected the coast, and that's what was trading with the world. But it was one of the most powerful periods of expansion. But then this begins to sunder apart. After, as India becomes independent, because our independence coincided with the partition of the subcontinent, the breakup of Punjab and Bengal, the two of the largest spaces in the subcontinent, historically united, and the drawing of the new boundaries there, which meant actually there were new frontiers to be defended, the securitization or the militarization of these new frontiers fundamentally weakened the central element that was integrating this region. And on top of it, that the fascination for socialism or inward-oriented economic structures essentially meant India adopted a conscious strategy to disconnect itself. While Britain was a trading entity, you now had an entity, the Nehru Raj, shall we say, essentially arguing, we're not interested in trade. We're interested in solidarity, of course. We're interested in the NAM, we're interested in what happens in the UN, but we're not interested in trade because everyone was doing socialism in one country. There was nobody who was not a socialist in Asia those days, in our own neighborhood. So therefore what you saw was how that political partition did not have to followed by an economic partition. But the economic partition happened logically from political partition because of the socialist economies that we created. Because after all, you could have imagined the two Punjabs or the two Bengals naturally continuing their trade relationships. But they did not, because one was the politics of defending these new frontiers and the other was the conscious economic policies that de-emphasized trade, that emphasized self-reliance, that looked at domestic growth on its own means. So that's the history that actually, so it is not about today, that's why when we say reconnecting the subcontinent, we're saying that today, that it was connected subcontinent 70 years ago, far more than it is today. Those of you who live here in Calcutta or in Lahore or in Amritsar know it better than anybody else in the subcontinent, that these were connected spaces. So the challenge is that much more difficult today when we talk about reconnecting as opposed to merely connecting, which is the problem in many other parts of the world. That brings me to the second set of issues in relation to geography. The geography, of course, those of us who do geopolitics, of course, we say geography is destiny, that say geography, physical geography is permanent, other things might change. But of course, these days with climate change, it's really, even physical geography is not permanent. And historically, I mean, if you look at a long geological periods of time, physical geography evolves fairly rapidly, often violently, rivers disappear, mountains collapse, all kinds of things happen in this planet Earth. So therefore, even physical geography is not a permanent feature. But of course, as far as our considerations, you could say, look, reasonably, that's a stable one. But I think what the nature of space, which is what geography is, can of course fundamentally change with the changing orientation of the societies within them. Just as I said, in the case of, you know, pre-partition India was outward oriented. There was capital from India moving goods, moving things, and an independent India goes the other way. So the nature of India's connections largely depends on the nature of its economic orientation. So therefore that is a fairly common phenomenon. So therefore politics and economics have as much to do with geography as we conceive of today than merely the physical circumstances. And what we saw in the 19th century actually was the dramatic expansion of the territories, Soviet Russia, not Soviet Russia, Tsarist Russia, essentially pushing itself to the east and to the south, the Khanates of Central Asia or Siberia, that the Soviet Russian expansion was fairly recent. It is not as if Russia always ruled these territories, but it is really essentially a 19th century phenomenon, the very period where colonial expansion was taking place. Similarly, British India, which by then had become a powerful entity, once it had got Punjab and Sindh, was pushing north, beginning to open up territories beyond the subcontinent, and eventually culminates in Young Husband opening up of Tibet and the Trans-Himalayan territories in the north, across the Brahmaputra in the east, and you see the exploration and expansion of territories. At the same time, Qing China too was expanding. In a sense, the China's, when we say talk about Xinjiang, Xin is new, the term word means new, but these were the new territories, whether it is the occupation of Yunnan, integration of Yunnan into China. So the Qin Empire too expanded significantly in the 19th century, and it's also a period when we saw it's not just merely control of the territories. The invention of the railways, of course, had a great effect on this capitalist expansion, and how the British Raj, the railway lines, the Grand Trunk Roads, the railway lines from Calcutta to Peshawar or Madras to Peshawar, that you began to see the pushing of the boundaries in this part of the world. And we saw also the maritime roads, the maritime connectivity, If you go back and look at any newspapers of 1942-43, the shipping advertisements, those days Statesmen and Hindu still used to carry advertisements on the front page. The shipping advertisements, so-and-so ships are coming and going, was a very central one. And the, much of the transportation took place, here were the three large ports in India. There was no Colombo then, not much. Singapore didn't much exist. So you had actually these three great cities were also port cities, and that the creation of these big port cities, of course, brought together their own integration. And then, besides the East India Company, by the beginning of the 20th century, of course, you had the Japanese talking about a Japanese capitalist expansion, Japanese imperialist expansion, the idea of Asian co-prosperity sphere. All these were part of the same story, in a sense, of expansion, of connectivity, of trying to bring resources together with the production centers. But all this, of course, pales in insignificance to what the Chinese are trying to do today, which is the One Belt, One Road initiative, which seeks today. Trains are already running from Chongqing in southwestern China to Duisburg in Germany. Trains are running to Madrid. If you look at the picture of the Chinese Silk Road, they're talking about connecting the Baltics. And all across Eurasia today, you're talking about the Chinese economic power of connecting, much in the way the railway lines moved from west to the east, whether it was the Tsarist Russia's railway line that came to Vladivostok, or the Russian railway line that came up to Tashkent and to the border of Afghanistan. Today it is the east that is pushing its railway lines outwards to the west, because China is the second largest economy, has extraordinary resources today to do what it can. I think the this is also the period. I think if you go back to see geography, as I mentioned, the geographic consequences of partition. There's one in terms of the human tragedies of Bengal and Punjab, but there was also consequences in geopolitical terms. You divided the two great river systems, the whole struggle that continues today of how do you divide the resources of the Indus and the Ganges, the two great river systems. That remains a problem. The militarization of the new frontiers that were created in Punjab and Bengal, I mean, in different levels is a problem. And if you look at the map today, how neatly India is blocked off to the east and the west by Pakistan and Bangladesh in some sense. In the east, at least, you have a chicken's neck. In the west, you're blocked off completely. So in a sense, if you look at the map of undivided India, where your connections with Iran to Burma till 1937, Burma was part of India. So you had this single, largely connected empire. And the post-partition subcontinent, which begins to be not only divided, but at odds with itself, which means that the nature of the division becomes that much more stronger. It was not just in terms of the geopolitics of it. For example, today one of the things of the Chinese Silk Road Initiative is how to do financial integration. They want Colombo to trade in yuan. They want all the major cities in the OBOR to trade in rupees. But again, I think we don't much like the British, but the Indian Gulf rupee was legal tender till the 67-70, I think, till Reserve Bank of India scrapped it in the Gulf. You could change your rupees easily. I mean, even now you can in Singapore. That the connectedness financially, because the Gulf and Singapore were really entrepôts to India. I mean, Aden was part of India till 1937. I think Singapore was part of India till 1867. So you had actually these two entrepôts in the Red Sea and on the Malacca Straits, essentially the far bookends of the British Raj, which were also the financial centers. But today you see some of that coming back. But the fact is, we consciously abandoned the Gulf rupee. We consciously abandoned the role of India as a security provider in the name of non-alignment and third world solidarity. That what China is today struggling to get in some senses was already your legacy in 1947. But then how we dealt with that legacy, I mean, I'm not saying it's not right or wrong at this point, it's irrelevant whether we call it right or wrong, but the fact is we must come to terms with, understand it. I mean, that it's not saying Nehru was good or bad. It's not saying so-and-so got it right or didn't get it right, but that's part of your story. But at least we must understand the journey that we made between being the centralizing, connecting element of the Indian Ocean to one where we got disconnected, both from the region and within ourselves. That is the tragedy of the partition, and the question is, today, is there a way of restoring or reconstituting it? That is the big question that animates us as we rethink geography and geopolitics in the region. A third thing that brings me to the political side of it, that I think this nature of the subcontinental division, of the great partition of the subcontinent, and the economic partition induced by socialist policies, today had to be changed under the influence of at least two, three trends that we've had for the last 25 years. One was the end of the Cold War, the division of the world into two large camps, also liberated large parts of the Eurasian landmass from Soviet control. The Soviet Union disappeared, the Stans all became independent, and some of the early connections that India now, we say, look, wherever we go, we say we've got a historic relationship. So in this case, I mean, you could say there was a historic relationship. But the fact was now you're trying to restore some of those connections with Central Asia. But the absence of a boundary with Central Asia significantly limits what you can do in Central Asia, but that's a different problem. We'll come back to it. Then the Washington consensus on globalization. It's shattering now because of the problems in the West, not in the East, because East has turned out to be a very good student of the West. But the impact of the logic of economic reform that came to South Asia in 1991, in fact, Sri Lanka started a little earlier than the others, that the same inward-looking regimes of South Asia now began to turn outwards and look for economic liberalization and globalization. That too began to alter our circumstance. And above all, then you had the China's rise under Deng Xiaoping. China's turn away from an inward orientation to an outward orientation, and the construction of modern Chinese capitalism, paradoxically under the Chinese Communist Party, under Deng Xiaoping, of course, dramatically changes China into the second largest economy in 30 years, with an expansive foreign currency resources, a great trading nation, and this now becomes the dynamo for regional integration that we're beginning to see. So it is now, if you look at this point, that there's three forces that are seeking connectivity of different kinds. One is the Americans, who talked about a new Silk Road when Hillary Clinton beginning to say, look, we need to connect different parts of Asia. And it had two, three elements. One, I think, they changed the South Asia Bureau. They took the Central Asian part from the European Bureau and connected it. Now the bureau that deals with us is called South and Central Asia Bureau. It is the guys who did it said, look, this is the great Mughal original connection between Central Asia, South Asia. There's a whole range of ideas the Americans do in terms of electricity supply from Tajikistan to Pakistan and India, or trading, restoring the old trading routes, the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India pipeline. So the attempt at reconstructing some of the old routes between Central Asia and South Asia, that the Americans have tried, but then the Afghan conflict, of course, limits how far that can go. There is also the problem for the Americans. Of course, Americans don't have money. They say, yeah, we'll take you to the World Bank, we'll take you to the financial institutions. You just come up with ideas, we'll do something for you. I mean, the problem is, and the Americans also don't do the kind of things they did before. They don't build bridges, they can't dig oil. All that stuff is now done by the Chinese and other companies. For example, when we were young, at least, there was this called companies like Bechtel and the big construction companies. You must have heard of Rockefeller's, the SoCal, the Standard Oil of California, which went into Saudi Arabia, opened up this crazy, what a Rubal Khali, they say. It's an empty quarter. It's called, on the map, you call it empty quarter, 60 degrees or 50 degrees centigrade. You dig for oil out there. Today, Americans don't do that. I mean, they all do financial engineering. They sit in New York in front of the computers, knowing algorithms. But the physical task of building bridges, of roads, who's doing that today? These are Chinese friends who are doing that. Going to the interior of Congo and say, look, we're going to build a bridge across Congo. We build a pipeline between Yunnan and Bay of Bengal, 2 years flat. Across the terrain of Burma, you have this pipeline, an oil pipeline and a gas pipeline built in 2 years flat. So today, if the Chinese have the resources to do things which the Americans can talk about, cannot really do. So the scale of the Chinese proposals, initiatives, that's why is quite dramatic. And I think a lot of it is again, I think, is not new. Some of it, if you look at the Chinese initiatives, if you look at the recent origins of it, there was a strategy called the West Region Development Strategy. You remember Deng Xiaoping famously, the reformers premised you had to move away from the, shall we say, the stupid notion of equality. Everybody's boats are not, all boats are not going to rise at the same time. So Deng Xiaoping's genius, if you want to call it that, was to say, let some people get rich first. So he says, look, the coastal regions will develop first, and once we develop the coastal regions, we'll then connect the interior regions. So by the time Jiang Zemin's rule came in 1999, you're now beginning to say the saturation of the coastline, the east coast development, therefore now we're going to go to the interiors, and the go west strategy of developing China's interior. So the consequence of this plan for west region development, you saw the railway line come to Tibet. You see the South Xinjiang Railway being coming to Kashgar, which is onto the west. You see the pipelines from Shanghai to Central Asia. So the development of the west regions also had an international dimension, which was they can only develop if they connect to the neighboring countries. So therefore Yunnan wants to do things with Burma. That's why K2K, when Hari talks about K2K, you're talking about why Kunming wants to connect with the bordering with Calcutta or some other place. But this again is not entirely new. I mean, I think if you go even a little back, Sun Yat-sen is a forgotten figure today, but Sun Yat-sen was the first Prime Minister of the Republic of China. But then when he lost power in the first government, he came back into the second coalition. I said, look, okay, I can't be Prime Minister, but make me the Railways Minister. He just wanted to be the Railways Minister. I mean, we know what our Railways Ministers have done in India. But if you say Sun Yat-sen, Railways was a passion, just as for Lenin it was about communes and electricity or socialism. But for Sun Yat-sen, Railways was modern China. Railways was about nationalism. Railways was about uniting the country. Railways was about extending China's influence around the world. So Sun Yat-sen's map, if you go and see Sun Yat-sen's map, of a railway that takes you all the way to Cairo, to India, to all corners of Eurasia. So what Sun Yat-sen was dreaming at the beginning of the 20th century, the Chinese have largely fulfilled that task. If you go back to 1947, India had a larger railway network than China had, I mean, almost four times larger. But today, Chinese railway system is, of course, is at least two times larger than, three times larger than what we have. It tells you how railways as a notion of connector, and the Chinese Communist Party today says, no city should be more than 4 hours away by railway line, six from Beijing, because Beijing is in one corner. But the fact is, you're talking about a high-speed railway system that's going to connect every corner of China, bring it within 6 hours of Beijing. So in a sense today, the original ideas of Sun Yat-sen today have gained a very, very powerful influence. So therefore, today the Chinese initiative then is not just the whims and fancies of one person, that it is the culmination of the Chinese capital and its expansive, explosive expansion beyond. And the Chinese Belt and Road Initiative, of course, will also have military, political, and strategic dimensions. And I think partly dealing with that has been the problem for India for quite some time to come. So it brings me to the fourth section in terms of looking at India's ambivalence to the Chinese strategy. Essentially, what you're saying is that, look, we see what the Chinese are doing, we can understand what the Chinese are doing. But given the nature of our relationship with China, we find it hard to work with them to collaborate. For example, when the Chinese talk about a China-Pakistan economic corridor, it runs through Kashmir. Pakistan occupied Kashmir, therefore it violates, it's my sovereign territory, how can you do that out there? Not that it makes a bit of a difference to what the Chinese do there, but the fact is that you have the problem of the sovereignty issue with the CPEC corridor, and of course, and then you have the BCIM corridor, the Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar corridor, which is in the east, which essentially wants, this is the K2K corridor, which wants to link Kunming with Calcutta by road. There our problem is, we haven't said no, but we haven't said yes. We are in a committee trying to string it out. You know, all of you know what committees are meant for. Committees are meant to delay things. So we have formally agreed to a committee which actually essentially kicks the ball down the road, and very little is actually happening. And the Chinese then come up with the idea of a maritime Silk Road, essentially connecting Sri Lanka, southern India, all this with the Chinese eastern seaboard, then of course it raises fears about encirclement. Chinese are encircling India, and of course there are also factors. Chinese are not just building a port in Colombo, Chinese submarines are also coming to Colombo. Chinese are not just building a port in Gwadar, a Chinese nuclear submarine last month showed up in Karachi. So then it comes in a, it doesn't come in a single package. I mean, it's only economics. Okay, you say we'll do it, but because it's combined with strategy and military, therefore the how India deals with it has remained a problem. But what this, the Chinese initiatives on connectivity, I think, have done one thing, which is at least shake India out of its stupor, in Delhi at least out of its stupor, that today that you need to do more on integrating your region has been at least set as a political goal under the previous administration. I mean, as I said, Manmohan Singh repeatedly has said many initiatives were taken, for example, building on the trade facilitation. Today, if you, there's not much trade on India-Pakistan border, but if you go there, you see this new beautiful facility, you know, integrated integrated custom station, that land station that has been built outside Amritsar. We're having problems in the east to do that. But the fact is, at least today, we're talking the language of connectivity. We're talking of projects that will actually do this. But the problem under the UPA government was of implementation, was the capacity to actually move things. Even declared goals were difficult to implement. And what we've seen is, at least last 2 years, much greater commitment to the notion of connectivity. At least there's some follow through in terms of pushing projects. You would be better judged. At least from Delhi, at least it seems that there's more things are being done in the northeast of connecting through putting more resources into the railway construction, etc., that's beginning to happen. So there's certainly some energy and vigor, essentially recognizing the fact that if you don't get your act together, the problem of dealing with the Chinese influence, economic influence in the subcontinent, is going to get a lot worse in the coming years. That brings me to the last but one issue, which is on Modi's strategy in terms of where is it likely to go. I mean, what are the possibilities for changing some of the ambivalence into a more purposeful strategy? One, I think the China problem has to be cracked in one form or the other, which is, look, you saw what the Chinese have done to us today. They've locked us out in the nuclear suppliers group. So it's no one's claim that the Chinese are going to be nice to you. But they say, look, this is not a bilateral issue, because after doing what they did to you, this is not a bilateral issue, this is a multilateral, this is about NPT, you are a victim, just as in the UNSC, it's not about you, it's about the Japanese or something else. But the fact is, China is the second largest economy. You might not like the Chinese, but the Chinese economic power is out there. And then on top of it, we have joined the Chinese-led economic institutions, because having spun out the tale of how bad the Western economic institutions are, I mean, you're all in Calcutta. I mean, I was in JNU, so we know how Bretton Woods, you know, destroying Bretton Woods was a dream for us as growing up. Well, welcome to the Chinese-led institutions in AIIB. I mean, you can have fun there. I mean, it is, if that's what you're going to get, jumping from the Western frying pan into the Chinese fire, you're very much welcome. But there we are, speaking of multipolarity, speaking of non-Western institutions out there, actually justifying Chinese-led institutions under BRICS, under SCO now, under AIIB, and the Chinese think they owe you nothing when it comes to anything in relation to Europe. Now, there's a problem, but that is the problem that you have. But this problem is not going to be solved by getting angry, but the fact is, you have to deal with the second largest power. And part of the problem, many of the problems of our intellectual laziness on foreign policy have largely stemmed from the fact we did not have to deal with a large power on our boundaries. Under the Raj, there was a bit of a threat about the Soviet threat and the, not Soviet, the Russian threat, the Russian quest to warm water ports, the Russian, you know, challenge in Afghanistan. But the fact was, Russians was too far away, Moscow was too far away. But today, the Chinese economic power of the kind that we see is something that we were the power in the 19th century. It was Indian power that was radiating into Tibet. It was India that was pushing opium into southern China. That was India cracking the whip in the Gulf. That was the Indian army that was securing large parts. But today, you have a power on your neighborhood, which is a powerful economic entity, and whose military capabilities are growing. Therefore, how do you deal with this? I mean, this is of a scale of a challenge which has nothing to do with our self-delusions about disarmament, non-alignment, third world stuff. That's all fine. Be my guest to think and reflect on those. But you still have to deal with the power on your frontiers, which is in alliance with one of your neighbors, Pakistan. Today, that alliance is increasing to Sri Lanka, to Bangladesh, to Myanmar. How do you deal with that? I mean, purely as a power question, what is it that you're going to do? And whatever strategy you do, I mean, I think the question of connectivity then, if you don't connect your markets, I mean, that you can say, look, the Chinese are terrible people, they have a bigger trade with Sri Lanka than we have. I would say that's a shame on India, not on China, right? That if there's only Park Strait that divides you, and if Sri Lanka has a bigger trade with China, which is 6,000 miles away, it's not Chinese genius, it is somewhere your failure that actually, that you're unable to trade with your neighbors. You are unable to connect your neighborhood in a way that you ought to. So how much we criticize the Chinese, I mean, I think we got to reflect on our own failures. That Bangladesh and India have 4,060, probably exactly two, that's the longest border that we have. Not an anarchic border, but I suppose everything goes on all the time. But why is it is so difficult to do things between the two countries? I mean, things have improved a lot, but the fact is it is still not one that is actually connected. So therefore, I think the problem is partly with us. So therefore, the central to that is how do you connect with your neighbors then becomes a very important element. And linked to this is, what about your own internal connectivity? Okay, I'll build a beautiful road. I mean, all of our friends are doing, ORF is doing a project on India-Burma connectivity. We'll do this trilateral beautiful highway. The last one we did got washed away, of course. That you do this connectivity between Manipur to Burma to Thailand, this beautiful, you know, east wing. But what's the point if you build a beautiful road, but you don't have a road inside? From the border to your own internal, many of you know the situation, that how bad the situation is in the northeast. Or you do this big dam, project in Burma, the Sitwe project. But the road in Mizoram is still not complete. So therefore, your internal connectivity, having external connectivity is of no consequence if you don't have internal connectivity, especially in your frontier areas. I think in the north and the east, there was a deliberate strategy to disconnect. That was part of the legacy of the post-war defensive Indian strategic culture, that we said we shouldn't connect the last mile. Imagine, that's a strategy. Don't connect the last mile to the frontier. And today the challenge is, look, if you don't change your frontier policy internally, that your ability to connect with the neighboring countries then becomes that much more difficult. Therefore, doing the internal connectivity becomes important. And then you have the whole question of ports today. If you look at the top 50 container ports in Asia, it was the top 10 Chinese are 6 of them. The first Indian port in the top 50 figures at 32. And this was the great trading nation under the Raj, that today you have one port in the top 50, the JNPT. So therefore, building ports. Because today, if your imports and exports today of Indian economy are close to 50% of your economy. Therefore, I think the task then of actually modernizing your own internal connectivity, modernizing your connectivity to the rest of the world, becomes a huge challenge. And I think this government is beginning to talk about it. They're trying to revive the program called Sagar Mala, which is to modernize the ports in India. They're also talking about doing more things with Japan and the US. Because China is not the only game in town. As I said, the Japanese have a strategy of their own. It's called Partnership for Quality Infrastructure. Japanese are doing very interesting things in Bangladesh, in Burma, in Sri Lanka. And the Japanese are eager to work with India to promote connectivity within the subcontinent and within India itself. So therefore, there are options today that you can work with the Japanese, and the Americans are willing to support these processes in a big way. So therefore, the challenge is, how do you define the strategy then, which is really that my view is, if there is a specific project on which you can work with the Chinese, work with them. That it is not the macro slogan, are you for or against the OBOR? That's what the Chinese want to know, much like George Bush. I don't have to answer the question, look, if the BCIM corridor suits me, or if the Chinese are willing to give me a specific, look, this is the framework, I say, I'll go with it. So that should be an answer based on a due diligence of a particular corridor, not on Chinese motivation. So therefore, what you need is that specific, individual, tailored response. If the BCIM corridor suits me, I'll go for it. I believe there is a lot of interest in the Stillwell Road now. Stillwell Road is what Americans built in the Second World War to support China from India. A small stretch in India, a large part of it in Burma, a little bit in China. I don't know what it does, but nevertheless, there are specific proposals which can be developed on the basis of specific due diligence on each one of them. Then, if Japanese are willing to do things with us, Japanese are bringing money into it, we say, look, if the Japanese want to do something between India and Bangladesh, or if they want to develop a corridor through Northeast into Myanmar, we should say, look, okay, this is a good project, we'll work with. Or if the Japanese are willing to work with India and say, look, let's do a port project in Sri Lanka, maybe tomorrow Trincomalee or something else we can develop, then take that project. So I think the thing is, if the objective should be connectivity, and there's no road that goes only one way. So therefore, the question is that if someone is going to help you build that connectivity, whether it is the Chinese money or the Japanese money, we should be able to take it and do that. And that should be our long-term strategy. And finally, let me come to if even a limited part of the strategy succeeds, I think it is much of that is going to happen in the eastern part of the subcontinent. Thanks to Pakistan, I mean, Pakistan is not ready to do things. They would rather do with the Chinese. We got a whole lot of other problems. So the subcontinent as a whole, under the SAARC framework, is not going to go very far. And that's what saw Modi government actually in Kathmandu SAARC summit last time. Okay, there was a motor vehicle agreement, there was a road connectivity agreement, which Pakistan is not willing to sign. We said, okay, the four of us will do it. India, Bangladesh, Bhutan and Nepal. So the BBIN initiative was one, okay, that should be your answer. Look, there is a two-speed South Asia, that those of us who can move forward need not wait for the others to come, like Pakistan. Therefore, the eastern subcontinent, where actually, thanks to the improved relationship between India and Bangladesh, that it is possible today. I believe the transit has started last week. Remember, 20 years ago, to talk about transit was like war with our friends in Bangladesh. But today it's beginning to happen. So therefore, I think working the eastern subcontinent, for some of my friends in Nepal call it East South Asia, that the future is in East South Asia, that East South Asia can be integrated over land. And the Bay of Bengal, thanks to the resolution of the territorial disputes today, it's also possible to do more things in the Bay of Bengal. It is possible to do, I think of a Bay of Bengal community which looks at India, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand getting together. Talk about the Northeast. It's really nowhere to nowhere. I mean, I think large parts of Northeast are not productive, or parts of Northern Burma are not productive. But if you connect the Indian Peninsula, the South Indian Peninsula, to Thailand through the Chennai-Dalway corridor, you're talking about actual production networks being formed. And I think those have a huge possibilities. So therefore, it is in the East. And I think if you do it in the East, I think Calcutta in some senses will reclaim its centrality in this whole region, that what was once the imperial capital, what was once the point from where Indian capitalism or was in an Indian strategic thought was in an expansive framework, that it is possible to restore quite a bit of that if Calcutta regains its center, its role as a city that connects, that brings together the business interests and the whole range of other things, production networks, markets. And that this can become the vehicle for integration. That is the challenge. I think that's where the historic opportunity for Calcutta presents itself, whether it is through the BBIN initiative, through the Bay of Bengal initiative, or even the Trans-Himalayan initiative. And I think if you look at India's historical engagement with Tibet, with Bhutan, Nepal, much of it was centered around Calcutta. And today, an expansionary India would still want to do that from Calcutta. In Delhi, nobody has time for that, but I think restoring the city, I think in some sense, becomes a critical part of your reconstitution, reconstruction of an India that is connected within the subcontinent and beyond. So I would conclude by saying, for all our difficulties and problems that we've had with connectivity, today the larger forces are compelling us. The nature of the Indian economy has changed. As I said, out of a $2.4 trillion economy, nearly 40% of that is imports and exports. Today you've got to be connected to the world. Second, Indian footprint today in the world, with a diaspora of 30 million people, that the way India is connected to the outside world today, it's historically never been there before. That India had its contacts in different parts, but the intensity of Indian engagement with the world today is dramatically different. India is today, after US and China, for China and the US in that order, has the largest stock of passports. Close to 100 million passports. Only three countries have 100 million passports, that is China, US and India. You're talking about then the scale of the connectivity that exists today. And I think it's also one in which we've seen ideas, yoga or something else today, that have resonance far beyond the subcontinent. So I would say that we've gone through a very difficult phase of shrinking ourselves, of diminishing our connectivities over the last 70 years. But today I think there is that historic possibility to reconnect ourselves both to the subcontinent and to the world, and within which I would say Mount Calcutta will have a very central place in reconstituting that connectivity. Stop.